Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Sound of an ambulance siren always gives me the goosebumps. Why does the driver have to make it whine like that? Do you know? Right, an ambulance must get to the hospital in a hurry. Of course, not everyone goes to the hospital in an ambulance. Usually just emergency cases. People who weren't planning to go right away arrive in an ambulance. Most people know ahead of time that they're going to the hospital. So they just pack a bag and walk in the door. Why do people go to the hospital anyway? Nobody wants to go. But if something goes wrong, something happens inside your body machine that your doctor can't take care of in his office, or if you get hurt in an accident, the hospital is the place to go to get fixed up. Have you ever been to the hospital? Maybe you had your tonsils out and stayed overnight? Or did you have your appendix out and have to stay quite a few days? If you've never been to the hospital, the first time can be a scary experience, but it can be exciting too. And that's the way Jonna Eller felt when Dr. Watts told her that she would have to go to the hospital to have an operation on her knee. A little bit frightened, and excited, too. There are big hospitals and little hospitals. Children's Hospital in Boston, the hospital Jonna Eller went to, is a big hospital. It looks big on the outside, and it looks big on the inside, too. Jonna and her mother walked down a long corridor before they came to the reception desk and found somebody waiting to help them. "Hello, Jonna," the lady said. "We were expecting you." I guess you know from the name of the hospital that all the patients there are children. And everybody there, like the woman who signed Jonna in, is there for one reason: to help children who have problems get well quickly and go home again. Jonna told the woman her name and answered all the questions she asked her. Mrs. Eller helped with anything Jonna didn't know or couldn't remember. Jonna was feeling better. The butterflies that had been fluttering around in her stomach all morning weren't fluttering anymore. Like all patients entering a hospital, Jonna was given an arm bracelet with her name and hospital number on it. She was pleased with her hospital bracelet. Now she was really a patient. Then Jonna was sent into the waiting room to wait until her room was ready. And the waiting room in a children's hospital is a very interesting place. Two children were drawing pictures at one of the tables while they waited. And who was sitting with them? The biggest stuffed dog Jonna had ever seen. But that wasn't all. There was a hobby horse. Giddy-app! This is wonderful. Maybe those butterflies are gone for good. What happened next? Well, that box may not look like the thermometers you've seen, but Jonna had her temperature taken. You know, there are lots of people at the hospital all the time, just waiting to take care of the children who come in. And who's the most important person in the hospital? The patient. You, if you're the patient. And that's the way the people Jonna met treated her. They made her feel like someone special. So did the next person she went to meet, the lab technician. Lab technicians in the hospital do many important things. One thing they do is check the patient's blood to find out if it's healthy. They do tests on it to find out the number of red cells and white cells in it and other things like that. In order to do this, first they must get a sample of the patient's blood. The laboratory technician who took a sample of Jonna's blood was so friendly and pleasant that Jonna didn't mind too much, although it did hurt a little. She wrapped a piece of tubing around Jonna's arm, wiped a spot clean with antiseptic, inserted a needle, and drew off some of Jonna's blood. Yipes! Jonna felt better when that was over. After that, she pinned a medal on Jonna for being so brave. But Jonna didn't feel so brave a little later, lying in her hospital bed, wearing a hospital johnny. She was glad her mother was there to comfort her and talk to her. But soon it was lunchtime, and Jonna felt better. She ate nearly everything on her plate and drank her milk, too. The table Jonna ate her lunch off of was neat. It fit right over her bed. And after the nurse's aide took her tray away, Jonna used the table to play a game with her mother. The next person Jonna had to see was the most important of all, her doctor, Dr. Watts. Jonna was glad to see him. He was glad to see her, too. He asked her lots of questions while he looked at her knee. Does it hurt here? Or here? Or here? Okay, he said, and sent Jonna off in a go-kart to have her knee x-rayed. How many of you have ever been x-rayed? Even if you haven't, you know what x-rays are for, don't you? You know that doctors use x-rays to take pictures of the inside of your body to find out if anything is wrong. Would you be afraid to have an x-ray? Do you think Jonna was afraid? She was a little bit afraid, but she didn't have to be, because the x-ray she had didn't hurt at all. Jonna thought the x-ray technician was very pretty. She watched her pull the big camera down close to the table where she was lying. When the camera was right over Jonna's knee, the x-ray technician put out all the lights and took the x-ray picture. Jonna didn't move a muscle. The next morning, Jonna was given some medicine to make her sleepy, wheeled on a traveling stretcher to the operating room, and then... My. Well, it wasn't over quite that fast. But before she knew it, Jonna was back in her room with her leg in a big fat cast. She felt kind of woozy and sleepy, but she was okay. For the rest of the day, Jonna had to lie very still. She was too sleepy to sit up and eat from a tray, so she had to be fed through her blood vessels like this. The board-like thing kept her from moving her hand by mistake and pulling out the tube. It was awkward, but no, it didn't hurt. When she felt wide awake again, she was glad to see her mother sitting there beside her. Dr. Watts came to visit her and ask how she was feeling. And of course, there were nurses and nurses' aides wishing in and out all the time. No one leaves the hospital right after an operation, and neither did Jonna. She spent lots of time in the playroom, painting and just resting. Other kids who had been there before her had decorated the playroom with lots of interesting pictures and things. Magic day when Jonna could go home. So Jonna's mother packed her suitcase for her, and Jonna walked out of the hospital on her crutches. Jonna Eller didn't have to walk with crutches for very long. Now she runs and plays without any crutches at all, and without any pain in her knee. And when she thinks of Children's Hospital and all the wonderful people there, she says, if you have to go to the hospital, don't be afraid. A hospital isn't a bad place at all. It's a good place to go to get well. I agree.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Fun. Do you know what this kind of painting I'm doing is called? Finger painting, that's right. It feels so lovely and squishy when you run your fingers over the wet paper like that. And the paint on your hands feels so kind of smooth and silky when you rub them together. But I guess you know that already if you've ever done this kind of painting. Oh, that gives me an idea. You rub your hands together. That's right. Now, why do you feel something when you do this? Do you remember those pathways inside your body that send messages to your brain? Raise your hand if you do. Good. Hands down. And what are those pathways called? Nerves. Good for you. Well, the feeling we're talking about right now is the kind of feeling you feel through your nerves. When you do this, nerves in your skin send messages to your brain. But there's another kind of feeling, too, that comes from inside. Do you know what I mean? You have a feeling inside you right now, and only you know what that feeling is. And, of course, I have a feeling inside me, too. I feel happy. I'm happy to be alive, I'm happy to be me, and I'm happy to be doing what I'm doing right now. I like talking to you. But do you think I feel happy all the time? Do you? No. Feelings can change.
What is this?
Oh, what are you doing here?
What do you mean, what am I doing here? I'm Marvin Meany, and I can go anywhere I want. The question is, what are you doing?
I'm finger painting.
Oh, that's what this mess is. Finger paint. What do you want to waste your time doing something like that for?
Because I like to do it.
You do? Tell me, what's that funny looking thingamajig supposed to be?
This?
No, no, no. That other ugly thing.
This?
Yes, that one. What's that supposed to be?
It's a fish.
A fish? Is that what that's supposed to be? Ah, 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 ah. And what's that so-called fish doing? Tell me quick.
Well, it's big fish and little fish playing hide and seek in the seaweed.
If that's supposed to be a fish, you're not a very good artist. I could draw a better fish than that. Besides, fish don't play hide and seek.
Okay, Marvin Meany, if you're so smart, why don't you come down here and paint a better fish?
Me? Never. You've made enough of a mess already, all by yourself. That's a dumb picture, if you ask me. I've got better things to do than waste my time drawing stupid fish. Boy, that's a stupid...
But I didn't ask you. Anyway, you know, I'm not feeling so happy anymore. How would you feel if you were doing what you thought was a very nice picture and someone came along and said mean things to you the way Marvin did to me? How would you feel? Unhappy, I bet. I think you would. And mad? You might be mad at him. And what else? Hurt? Be honest with me now. Raise your hand if you would be hurt if Marvin Meany or anyone else said those things to you. Oh, will you look at that? Look around the room. Does that mean that everyone's feelings can be hurt? I think it does. Okay, hands down. And does that also mean that everyone here should take care not to hurt the feelings of everyone else here? Why? Because for one thing, everyone has feelings just like you. That's right. And hurt feelings can't be wiped away as easily as finger paint. And hurt feelings can last for a long, long time. Well, we've talked about happy feelings and hurt feelings. Are there other feelings? Let's think about that. Oh, maybe this will help. A long time ago, when I was about 11, my parents went out for the evening and they left me to babysit for the first time with my two younger sisters. And when my mother and father got home, they found this note from me. They were brats. They sat in the bathroom and giggled for 10 minutes. Nancy lay on her back on the hall floor, kicking it with her heels. Marjorie hid in the linen closet. Marjorie banged on the bathroom door with her fists. Marjorie punched me into my room. Boy, was I mad. I was burned up. But my two little sisters were having a ball. They just kept on doing things that made me madder, and they got sillier and sillier. Have you ever felt like that? Can you think of a time when everything you said was funny? You just couldn't stop laughing? Maybe even you laughed so hard until you cried? Raise your hand if that's ever happened to you. I'm sure it has. This wild, goofy, silly feeling sometimes happens when good friends get together, and it's great to be silly once in a while. Now, what other feelings have I had that I think you have had too? How do you think I felt when I woke up one morning when I was your age and my pet turtle, Pokey, had died in the night? Sad, yes. I cried and I cried. Do you think it made any difference that I was a girl? I mean, if I were a boy, do you still think I would have cried? Yes, I think so. Boys and girls have the same feelings. Big boys do cry. Has your best friend ever moved away? Mine did. My best friend, Charlie, moved far away when I was 9 years old. I was so lonesome, I didn't know what to do. We had played together every day, after school, on weekends, and on holidays. I missed him so much, and I just kept wishing that he would come back. Sad feelings, happy feelings, silly, mad, lonesome feelings. Can you ever have more than one feeling at a time? Can you have mixed feelings? Yes, you can. Do you remember the first day you went to school? How did you feel? Excited? Scared? Shy? Maybe disappointed? Proud of yourself? Kathy is going to tell us how she felt on her first day of school.
I was excited and happy about this special day. But I was glad Mommy and Daddy went with me and took my hand because I didn't know much about where I was going. It was fun to meet new friends. I had a new dress I liked a lot. I kissed Mommy goodbye, but I didn't want her to go. I wished she could stay a little longer. My teacher's name was Mrs. Sykes, and I thought she had a nice face. The desks were smaller than I dreamed they were. I sat between a girl named Kelly and a boy named Derek. They were new friends. Everyone had a rabbit with their name on it to hang around their neck. Some were red and some were white. Mine was red. We stood up to say the salute to the flag. Kelly got a little mixed up at first, but she'll know how to do it right tomorrow. Eric whispered to me he wanted to go home. I guess he was feeling lonesome. We had some work to do. I folded my hands and listened carefully because I didn't want to make a mistake. Kelly knew what to do better than I did. She let me look at her paper. After a while, we all got in line and went outdoors. We sat on the grass to hear a story. My hands were icy cold in school, and the sun felt good on my hands and face. We had to learn what to do in the cafeteria, where to put your money, and how to carry a tray. So we had a rehearsal. My teacher helped me. We all sat down with our trays and listened so we would know what to do from now on. I was hungry. We had hot dogs. Soon it was recess. I was worried. What if nobody wanted to play with me? But somebody did. Two friends from my street at home saw me standing there. Soon we were playing a giggly twist-up game called Dr. Tangle. It was lots of fun. There were many things to look at in our room. We even had a puppet of our own. Turkey Puppet asked me a question. I didn't know what to say. Everybody laughed. I did too. Just before going home, we did fun things, like making soap bubbles. I blew some bubbles and Eva tried to catch them. Soon we lined up to go home. It was raining so hard, many parents came for their children. My mother came too. I couldn't wait for her to find me. I had so much to tell her about my first day at school.
Well, we've learned a lot about feelings today, that some feelings are happy and some feelings are not happy, that everyone has feelings that can be hurt, and that just as Kathy did on her first day of school, you can have mixed feelings. And we also learned that everyone has feelings, and not just children, grown-ups have feelings too. I had a special feeling when my little girl Emily made me this notepad and gave it to me with "I love you, Mommy" written on it. Is love a feeling? Yes, of course. It's a very special feeling. And it's probably the best feeling in all the world.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Just touched me. Oh. Oh, what a terrible feeling. Oh, for heaven's sakes, I was asleep. I must have been dreaming. Let me tell you, that was a bad dream. Did you ever have a bad dream that made you feel afraid? Oh, then you know what I mean by feeling afraid. It's that feeling you get when you think you're in danger. It's not really a good feeling, is it? Of course, nobody wants to be afraid. Certainly not all the time. But is everybody afraid sometimes? Is everyone afraid of something? Well, everyone I know is. Grown-ups, little children, kids your age. Anyone who says that they're never afraid isn't telling the truth. Everybody is afraid sometimes. Being afraid is one of the things that helps keep you safe and healthy and alive. It isn't dumb to be afraid. The other day, I asked some children your age to draw pictures of some of the things that they're afraid of. They're interesting. Let's look at what they drew and listen to what they had to say about it.
I always think there's a vampire under my bed and a werewolf gonna strike me, so I always hide under my sheet. The vampire's all black and has a little black cap on. And the werewolf has ripped pants on and all hairy and blood on his fingers.
I'm afraid of a rattlesnake because if it bites, you could die. When I was two, I saw a rattlesnake, but I can't remember what it looks like. My friend, because it would put its tongue out and I was scared of its tongue.
A fire, unless someone there was two on the street. This is my window up there, and there's my lamp, and that's me in bed, and that's the ghost. He has his hands up in the air. He has a face, but no, I can't see no head. He has a sheet over him. His arms are all white. Then I jump out of bed and go under my bed.
My big brother always was afraid of bees. He said he got stung inside his stomach. And he told me once he got bitten on the nose. So he got me afraid of bees.
When I went in the Washington Monument, like when I looked down, there were all these people watching, and they looked like little toys. I was scared when I went up because the windows were like big, and they were about as big as me, and I thought that I might fall out of one.
One night, I went to sleep and it started to thunder and lightning outside. The biggest crack of lightning almost hit our backyard tree. So I woke up and I didn't know what was happening, so I tried to turn on the light, but outside the wires had broken. I called my mother. She said, just go back to sleep and don't worry about it. Really, I've never gotten to sleep when thunder and lightning is outside.
When I come in a big room, there might be someone in there. I'm afraid that they might come out and grab me or take me away in a big black car. It is very scary to come in a big house like that and see nothing around the house because it is very dark.
How about that? Are you afraid of some of those things, too? Are you afraid of thunder and lightning? Are you afraid of snakes? Are you afraid of big dogs? Are you afraid of the dark? I was when I was little. I was afraid of the dark in my bedroom because I thought there was a monster in my closet. My monster had green face with warts all over it. Hollow eyes and a long crooked nose, stringy hair and yellow teeth. Ooh, it was ugly. I just knew that if my mother turned out the light and closed the door, the monster would creep out of the closet and pounce on me. I didn't dare go to sleep. I didn't dare close my eyes. Was there a monster in my closet? What do you think? No, there wasn't. Was there a monster anywhere? Yes, there was. Right here, in my head. I used my brain to think him up, to imagine him. I can laugh about it now, but when I was little and afraid, it wasn't any fun at all. Fun? Is being afraid ever any fun? Sure it is. Halloween, scary rides, the roller coaster, House of Horrors. Some of those things send shivers down your spine, don't they? But are you afraid of those things? I mean, really afraid? No? Why not? Isn't it because you know exactly what those things are, and you know that no real harm will come to you? Take the scary rides, for instance. You get a little frightened, but it's exciting. And once the ride is over and you're safe on the ground again, don't you usually want to go for another ride? I thought so. Have you always been afraid of something, even when you were tiny? When you were a baby, you were afraid of three things. You were afraid of loud noises, you were afraid of falling, and you were so scared of strange new people when they tried to hold you that sometimes you howled. These strangers were your friends and relatives, and once you got to know their faces, everything was fine. You weren't afraid anymore. Now, when a stranger smiles at you and says, "Good morning," I hope you smile back and say, "Good morning, too." Everybody's a stranger before they become your friend. But you know something? I hope you're still scared enough of people you don't know so that no matter what anyone offers to give you, you will never go for a ride or take a walk with anyone you don't know. Remember Dora Dingbat, who went for a ride with someone she didn't know? We laughed at her. But she was right to be afraid when she found out that the young man who gave her a ride on his motorcycle wasn't taking her home. You could meet someone who means to do you harm. It doesn't happen very often, but every year there are stories in the papers about children who are frightened or hurt by friendly strangers who turn out not to be friendly after all. So, I want you to remember this. If anyone you don't know tries to get you to go someplace with them, don't go. And be sure to tell some grown-up about it right away. As a matter of fact, don't go any place with someone you do know without getting your family's permission first. Your family loves you, and they want to know where you are when you're not with them, okay? Sometimes being afraid is a good thing, and this is one time it is. Say, remember those pictures we looked at earlier, the ones the children drew? Did you notice that the things they were afraid of were things they could see, like bees and snakes and dogs and lightning? Or things they imagined they could see, like vampires and ghosts and werewolves? How about things they couldn't draw pictures of? Are people sometimes afraid of things they cannot see, cannot draw pictures of? Are you afraid of some things you can't see? Nod your head, yes or no, if you're afraid of any of these things. Getting a bad report card, making a mistake and being laughed at, making a mistake or being laughed at when you didn't even mean to be funny at all, getting lost,
going home and finding no one there, being punished for something you didn't do? I don't believe you could draw a picture of any of these things, but I do believe that you could be afraid that they might happen to you. Fear is your friend when it keeps you from being hurt. But fear can be your enemy, too. It can make you very uncomfortable. It can make you tremble or sweat, giggle, cry, scream, feel sick to your stomach, or even, no kidding, too much fear can make you sick. Well, what can you do about your fears? How about hiding them? Why don't you just pretend they're not there and maybe they'll go away? That they won't do. Hiding your fears is just pretending they're not there. It won't work. What will? The best thing to do when you're afraid of something is to talk it over with someone. Tell your mother or father or some other grown-up, or tell your best friend about it. What happened to the monster in my closet? How did I get rid of him? I told my mother about him. I told her what he looked like and where he lived. And do you know what happened? He went away, just like that. So, if there's something bothering you, then before you go to bed tonight, why don't you find someone who will listen to you and see if you can talk that old fear to death. See you next time.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Did you know that some animals live in families? Geese do. Here are the baby goslings sticking close to their mother for warmth, while she keeps a watchful eye. One day, she coaxes them to follow her down to the water, and right away, they use their webbed feet to paddle along behind. Father Goose swims beside his family to make sure no snapping turtle comes near his little goslings. Baboons live in families called troops. A baby baboon likes to be cuddled and taken care of by its mother. It also likes to play with other little baboons. In a baboon troop, all grown-up baboons take care of the babies. There are many babysitters in a baboon family, and they all help teach the baby baboons what they need to know. Older baboon children help teach them by playing with them, teasing them, chasing them. The
See how the tiny baby returns to his mother for protection. In the lion family, mother lion teaches her babies how to keep clean, while father lion patrols his land, keeping watch. Baby lions like to play wrestling games. And mother lion teaches her cubs how to hunt. It's important that they know how to catch their food when they are grown up and have to hunt for themselves. Like other animal babies, the young lion cubs have many things to learn. A female cub has to learn how to take care of her family, and a male cub, well, I guess he has to learn how to be king of the jungle. Do you think that most animal families take good care of their babies? Yes, they do. They feed them and protect them and play with them. They keep them clean and cuddle them, and they teach them what they need to know in order to stay alive. That's what animal families are for. What about human families? What about your family? What is your family for? Do you think your family did for you as a baby the things that geese and baboons and lions do for their children? Sure they do. Here you are. But a family must be for something more than just having children and taking care of them. What else is a family for? When I asked my daughter Lisa that question, she said, "A family is for doing things together, for having fun with." Do you like that answer? So did I. In fact, I liked it so much that I asked some second grade friends of mine if they would draw pictures that show some of the things they like to do with their families. Let's look and listen to what they said about their drawings. Watch especially to see if you do some of the same things with your family.
We go to the beach all together, and my father and me or anyone else usually play ball or go swimming together, and he teaches me some stuff sometimes. And my sister just sits in the sand making sand castles. You know how little baby sisters or brothers like to do that. And my mother usually sits under an umbrella trying to get a tan. Likes to cook, and in the picture everyone is doing something. My mother is serving something on a tray, and my brother is playing checkers with my other brother. My father is reading the newspaper, and I am watching my mother. My little brother is watching the mole bear move around in circles.
We like to play games together. We like to work in different spots together. And we like to sit and talk together. We all go swimming, and we sort of play if the wave gets us, we have to go into the water, even though the water's sort of all cold. I play with my brothers, we play kickball, and we go up and we play with our friends too.
Sometimes we go out, we play basketball, and we play tennis sometimes too. And sometimes we eat outside, and I like to do that a lot. We usually do it on weekends and on birthdays.
One of the things I like best is camping. And in this picture where I was sitting on logs with a campfire and we're telling stories and things, and birds are flying around, and the fire is getting pretty dull because it's getting pretty late and the moon's shining.
Raise your hand if you saw something you do with your family. Raise your other hand if you saw more than one thing you do with your family.
Okay, you're out of hands, hands down. What else is a family for? When I asked my second daughter, Emily, she said, families are for helping each other. Is that another good answer? Mm-hmm, I agree. Does your family help each other? Does your family help you? And what do you do to help? Let's see. Do you sometimes fold the laundry and put it away? Do you help clear the dirty dishes off the table? Do you help give the dog a bath when he's dirty? Do you sweep the floor, especially when you've spilled something and made a mess? Do you help a younger brother or sister get dressed? Do you go to the store for your mother and father? Well, you may not do any of those things perfectly yet, but at least you're in there trying. The more people in a family, the more help is needed. And if your mother and your father both work, then your help is needed very much. Kids your age can help a lot, you know, and helping is a grown-up thing to do. Well, we've been talking all this time about families. What is a family? Are all families alike? Do all families have a father and a mother and a sister and a brother and a baby and a dog and a cat? No, they don't, do they? A family can have any number of people in it, any number of grown-ups and any number of children and pets. Is this a family? There's a father and a mother and a big boy and a baby girl and a dog. This is a family, isn't it? Is this a family? It has a mother and a grandmother and a grandfather and one little girl, two little girls, and a striped marmalade cat. Those little girls look so much alike, I think they must be identical twins. What do you think? Well, if they are, then that means that they inherited the same identical set of what? Genes, right. Good for you for remembering. Did you notice that this family doesn't have a father in it? Well, does a family have to have both a father and a mother to be a family? Many families don't have both, do they? Sometimes one parent is dead, or the parents are separated or divorced. You see, sometimes grown-ups can no longer get along together well, so one of them goes away. It doesn't mean that the one who goes away doesn't love you anymore. A mother or a father can love you very much, even if they don't see you every day. Is it your fault if your parents are divorced? Is it something you did that made it happen? No. Certainly not. Children often feel very badly about it, but they didn't do anything to cause it to happen. Anyway, for whatever reason, sometimes families have only one parent. Maybe it's a mother and maybe it's a father. And some families, like this one, have grandparents living with them. Older people, you'll find, make very good friends. Maybe you're one of those lucky kids that has the nicest grandparents in the world. Looking at the identical twins makes me wonder, do all the children in a family have to inherit their genes from the parents in order to be a family? Could this be a family? Yes, it is. I know this family. They live near me. How many children are in the family? Right, six. Four of the children look more like the mother and the father because they inherited their genes. Victoria and Juliana are adopted. Some families who have children of their own like children so much that they want more children in their family, and so they adopt them. Some families have no children, and they adopt children too. If you are adopted, then you know you are wanted very much because your family chose you especially. What is it that makes a family a special group of people? Yes, that's right. It's doing things together, and it's helping each other, and it's also talking to each other, joking and teasing and talking things over. What else makes a family a family? Fighting? Yes, even that. But family fights are usually soon forgotten. Sometimes bad feelings do happen in a family, but it's the good feelings that matter. The good feelings of loving and caring and sharing and sticking up for each other. I guess in the end, that's really what makes a family a special group. It's that warm feeling inside you that says, we're special people. We're together.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
I was up in my attic yesterday, and was I surprised to come across this old china tea set that I used to play with as a little girl. Sally Ann and I spent hours pouring endless cups of tea for our dolls and stuffed animals. Sally Ann was my imaginary friend. Did you ever have an imaginary friend? Don't laugh. Lots of kids do. It's okay to have an imaginary friend, but everybody needs a real friend, too. Do you have a real friend? Old friends are nice to have, but it's nice to make new friends, too. And how do you go about making new friends? Well, I can think of a lot of surefire ways how not to make friends. Visit any playground, look around, and I'm afraid you'll see things like this happening all the time.
Da da, ba da da. Da 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 da, hmm hmm hmm, ba 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 da, hmm 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 hmm, hmm hmm hmm, da da ba ba, da da da, da da ba da da da.
Hey, that's a neat ball. Thanks a lot.
Hey, wait a minute. Hey, give that back.
Fat chance. It's mine now, you jike.
But I had it first. It's mine.
It ain't yours. It belongs to the school.
But the teacher said I could play with it.
But she didn't say you can have it all day.
But I just got it.
No, you just had it. I got it now.
Give it back.
Make me, fathead.
Come on. Don't be a wise guy.
Wise guy, huh? I'll give you a wise guy.
Ow! Hey, you shouldn't have thrown that at me, you know.
Oh, you want to play rough, huh?
Oh, you couldn't right, just come along
in.
Take my ball from me.
Oh, I don't
come
do
on.
Anything I
Ow.
Want. I'm the king of
come
playing.
On, I want
come
my ball back.
Say,
give me my ball. I want it.
Does any of that sound familiar? Jerk, fathead, wise guy. That's no way to make friends, is it? How do you feel about being called names? Do you think it's true that sticks and stones will break your bones, but names can never hurt you? Suppose I said this to you, and I never would because I like you and I want us to be friends, but just suppose I said, "Hi, you dumb kids. Listen to me when I'm trying to teach you something. Don't just sit there like a bunch of brainless creeps." Would you think that I was your friend if I talked like that to you? No, I didn't think you would. That same puppet that was so full of names also kicked and hit and grabbed the ball away. Why does anyone do that? Well, it's hard to wait your turn. Sometimes you want to play with a toy at the same time that someone else has it. What can you do? Does that mean you have to grab it away? What do good friends do? That's right. They work those things out together by sharing, by taking turns. Let's see if that's what's going on over here in this other corner of the playground.
Did you like that guy in class today? His name is Paul. Ugh. Yeah, he's icky, all right.
I'm tired of swinging. Let's do something else.
Hey, I don't want to play with her. Let's just ignore her. Let's leave her alone.
Hey, what are you whispering about?
I don't want to play with her at all, do you? She looks funny. She really does. She has red hair.
Hey, what's so funny?
We can't tell you. It's a secret. It's a secret, right? Yeah.
Come on. Let's play tag. You're it, Jennifer.
No. We don't want to play that game. The game we're going to play is a game for two.
What's the game?
We're not going to tell you. You ask too many questions. That's why your nose is so long. She looks just like Pinocchio, right? Right.
Oh, dear. Those girls didn't show up too well either, did they? How do you think that girl with the red hair feels right now? Oh, then something like that has happened to you? Isn't it an awful feeling to be left out, to be whispered about? What do those two giggling, whispering girls know about making friends? Not very much, that's for sure. Friendly people just don't go around leaving other people out, making fun of them, whispering secrets in front of them, calling them names, stuff like that. There's a boy and a girl playing together on the seesaw. Let's see if they're friendly people.
Know something? My father is the strongest man in the whole world.
Uh-huh.
He is. He can bend a horseshoe with one hand.
No, he can't.
Yes, he can. I've seen him do it.
It must have been a rubber horseshoe.
No, Dodo. A real horseshoe.
Nope. I don't believe you. Nobody can do that.
My father can.
Know something? You're telling a big... fat lie.
I am not.
Yes, you are.
Ooh, I'll show you.
Hey. Oh, hey, I'm going to tell my father on you. You just wait. You can't do that to me. Hey, Dad, he'll fix you. Oh, Dad.
Good.
goodness. It's the same old story, isn't it? Here are children who could be having fun together, and instead, they're bragging, boasting, arguing, calling each other liar, getting mad. That's not a good way to make friends, is it? Do good friends ever get mad at each other sometimes? Do they ever say, "Go away, I don't like you anymore"? Yes, friends do get mad sometimes. Friends aren't perfect, you know. Well, what can you do when you're mad at your friend? What's wrong with just going up to your friend and saying, "Listen, I'm mad at you," and then tell them the reason why? Talking things over with friends is one of the things that makes friendship work. You know, I'm beginning to wonder if there are any children anywhere on this playground who know how to make friends. I'm sure there must be. Let's try again.
Oh, wow! What a neat toy!
Yeah, I got it for my birthday.
Oh. Can I play with it too?
Sure.
Okay, good. You drive.
Okay, here we go.
Okay. Red light.
What's your name?
Mark. What's yours?
Debbie.
Okay. Oh, Debbie, I just had the neatest idea of all. The dog can ride on top.
No, he can't. The dog belongs in here.
Oh, can he ride on top just for now?
Well, all right.
Okay, good. Let's go.
Wow.
Great truck.
Go real fast.
Hey, what are you doing? We're going camping. Can I play too? It's her bus.
It's not a bus. It's a camper. But you can play too. You can get some firewood.
Okay. I got some firewood.
Oh, great. Good. Put it in
the
back.
Let's
over
go. Under the park.
Well, I must say, those children gave me a happier feeling than the ones we saw before. Did you notice how they were having fun sharing the camper? No grabbing, no arguing, no name calling. Do you think these children know how to make friends? I think so, too. So, we found some at last. Let's stop and think a minute. What are some things you can think of that are friendly things to do and to say? Yes, sharing is a friendly thing. You can share games, books, toys, wishes. And then you can think of some friendly words to say, like, "Please, thank you, can I help you, I like you." And you can greet your friends with a smile. Okay, so you know some good ways to make friends, but wait a minute, I can just hear someone saying, "I like to be alone, what's wrong with that?" Well, nothing. Everyone likes to be alone some of the time. But it's also nice to have someone special to do things with, like to show off with, to Indian wrestle with, to play house with, to ride bikes with, to find old junk with, to walk to school with, to jump rope with, to share secrets with, to dress up with, to make sandcastles with, to play hide and seek with, to explore the attic with, to eat peanut butter sandwiches with. That's what friends are for, and lots more besides. That's why it's nice to have friends. Of course, even if you do know friendly things to say and do, sometimes it isn't that easy to get to know someone, especially if you're shy. I was. It took me 2 weeks to get up enough courage to go visit the new girl next door and just say, "Hi, my name is Anne Louise, and I'd like to play with you." Even then, I had to take my mother along. I was so shy, I was afraid I wouldn't have the courage to say even that unless she was with me. What I didn't know was that the new girl was shy, too. I didn't know what to think when she just stood there looking down at her feet. Finally, we started to play without saying a word. And you know what? Soon we got so interested in what we were doing that we both forgot to be shy. Does a friend always have to be someone your own age? What do you think? One of my favorite friends when I was your age was a lady who lived in our neighborhood, Mrs. Miller. My idea of a good time was to go over to her house and help make cookies. And after the cookies were baked, we always had a tea party using Mrs. Miller's best dishes. So you see, friends can be any age, any size, any shape. Friends can be anybody. They can be a bus driver, a babysitter, a teacher, a mailman, milkman, a doctor, a lawyer, an Indian chief. I hope you have good friends. I'm sure you do. And I'm sure you always will. If you just remember this, to have a friend, you have to be a friend.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
Next on ITV, host Louise McNamara explains good health habits and how the body works to first and second graders on All About You.
WSKG-TV, Binghamton.
Trying to trick you into thinking that there was some strange new person here today. Or did you guess that it was me all along? You did? Aren't you smart? Is this good manners? It is in Malaysia, and that's where I'm pretending to be right now. Not everybody eats the same way, you know. Some people eat with forks and spoons. Others eat with chopsticks. And in Malaysia, and in many other parts of the world too, people eat with their fingers, and they sit on the floor when they eat. I've never tried Malaysian cooking before. This is a typical dish of rice and fresh vegetables, meat, and fish cooked in oil and covered with a sauce. Oh, and a very hot, spicy sauce, too. It's delicious. I must say, this is a handy way to eat it. Oh, the clothes I'm wearing. This is a cotton blouse and a sarong. These are just the right things to wear in a warm climate. They keep you cool and comfortable. My feet are comfortable, too. As you can see, I'm having a good time pretending I'm in Malaysia. But what do you suppose it would be like to really live there? Why don't we take a look at someone your age who does live there and see what we can see? This is Mooka. There are no school buses for Mooka and his friends. There goes the water buffalo to work. Mooka's school is an English school, so the boys dress very much like English boys do. That woman is cutting rice in the fields. At home, Mooka and his brothers and sisters speak their own language, but in school, they're learning to read another language, English.
My father works in the field with the water buffalo.
There's Mooka's father, working in the rice paddy.
My mother pets the rubber trees.
My mother pets the rubber trees.
That's Mooka's mother. After school. That looks like fun. Mooka gets to ride the water buffalo to the well. Everyone goes along to help. Ride's over. You'd be muddy too if you worked in a rice paddy all day. Mothers everywhere have housework, don't they? Mooka's mother doesn't have a washing machine, but she gets the clothes clean her way. Mooka's father said he's going to the market to buy some fish. Now, isn't that easier than going to the supermarket? Mooka's mother's picking some bananas for the supper while the kids play street hockey. And she picks a breadfruit right off the tree. Who's that banana for? Why, the family's monkey, of course. Father puts a leash on the monkey. Ah, see? What better way to get coconuts down? That's one useful monkey. You've had a glimpse of what Mooka's house looks like. Does it look like yours or any of your friends? How is it different? Let's take a closer look. This is a model of a house something like Mooka's. The sides are made of teak wood, which comes from trees in the forest nearby. The roof is covered with palm leaves. Do you think this is a comfortable house for a hot climate? Yes, it is. The roof and sides keep out the hot sun and let the cool air in. Did you notice you have to climb a lot of steps to get up into this house? Well, The house is built on stilts. Why is that, do you suppose? Yes, air can get underneath and make it cooler inside, but there's an even more important reason. When the rainy season comes, the water rises high, but not high enough to get into a house that is built on stilts. Now, what does this look at Mooka's life tell us? Lots of things. It tells us that here is a boy who does the same things you do. He eats and sleeps, works and plays, learns, goes to school, and yet he does them in a different way from you. Do you know what this is? Do you know what it stands for? The world, right? The planet Earth, the place where we all live. You and your family and friends, Mooka and his family and friends, and 4 billion other people besides. The others are people you don't know, but they are real people, just like you, with names and faces and thoughts and feelings. Almost everywhere you see land, there are people. Now, you live somewhere in this part of the world. And way over here, there, near the South Pacific Ocean, is where Mooka and his family live. Let's see some other children who live in this part of the world. Ong, the boy with the clay pot on his head, goes to the river every day with his friends to get water for his mother to wash the dishes and the floor. Sometimes he goes to the river to fish and to daydream. The small fish he catches when he's lucky, he dries in the hot sun. Weepa's family make parasols for a living. Weepa works in the open area under her stilt house, painting leaves and flowers on the parasols. The streets near Weepa's house are really canals. She goes to school on a boat bus. Here and here and here, on islands in the Pacific Ocean, are other children living. Let's see what we can find out about them. Haruko, a Japanese girl, is in the third grade. When she came into school today, she took off her shoes and put on sneakers. All the children did. This is a custom in most Japanese schools. Manuel lives in a big city in the Philippines. He plays in the school band and loves to march in parades. It is dance festival day in Samoa, and the children are practicing one of the dances. Over their wrap-around cloth skirts, they are wearing skirts made of tree bark that has been split into strips. Because Samoa is a warm, sunny island, most Samoan children go barefoot all year round. And halfway around the world from where Mooka and those other children live is this very large continent. Do you know what it is? Africa, right. It is very hot in most places in Africa. It is especially hot in the Kalahari Desert, where Kwi and his family live. Kwi doesn't go to school. His father teaches him how to hunt wild animals and how to make a fire. Kwi's tribe have to spend most of their time gathering food in order to stay alive. Latifa lives in Morocco. Latifa's mother is teaching her how to take care of their tent house, how to cook, and how to pour tea. Lots of children live in South America, too. Let's see. That's this continent here, just below ours. Jose and Ernesto live in Argentina. They help their father, who was a farmer, by working in the fields and by taking care of the oxen. Suka and her family live in South America, too. They are Indians. Suka takes her pet pig with her wherever she goes. While Suka's mother weaves, the whole family is taking care of a herd of llamas, which is grazing nearby. Now, what about some of the children who live in our own continent, North America? Right here. What about Ulak, who lives way up here where it is very cold most of the year. Or little Star, who lives about here where it is sometimes very cold and sometimes very hot. Ulak is an Eskimo boy who likes to go fishing in the boat his father made him of walrus hide. When the weather is warm enough and the ice is all melted, sometimes his brothers go fishing with him. Little Star is a Navajo girl. Her family earns a living raising sheep and goats. Little Star can shear a sheep herself. We've seen just a few of the more than 4 billion people that live in the world with you. Just a few of your relatives and mine. Your relatives? How can I say that? How can these children whom you've never met, probably don't look like and don't talk like, be your relatives? Well, there is one good answer. They are all human, just like you. That alone makes you related to everybody else in the world. And just like you, they get hungry and need to eat. They get cold and need to have clothes to wear. They get sleepy and they want a safe place to sleep. And they sometimes feel afraid and want to be comforted, or lonely and want to have friends. There are many different ways of living, but we all need the same things to stay alive. That's everybody else and you.
About You is a project of the Agency for Instructional Television.
In 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. In 1492.